Hello everyone, welcome to lesson 43 of our GoLang course. In the last lesson, I introduced methods. Along with methods, we also went over how methods can be of pointer or value receiver type. There are a few more things I wanted to cover about value and pointer receivers, which we will cover in this short lesson. So let's get started. First up, let's answer the question, which receiver type to use and when to use. Just like with regular function parameters, the decision between a value receiver and a pointer receiver in methods depends on whether you want to work with original data via a pointer or a copy of it. If you use a value receiver, the method operates on a copy of data and modification won't affect the original data. If you use a pointer receiver, the method still operates on a copy of pointer, but it gives you the ability to directly make changes on the original data via the pointer, allowing modification to affect the source. If methods need to modify the receiver, meaning it alters the state of object it's called on, it should use a pointer receiver, as we have already seen in the past lesson. If a method with a pointer receiver might be called on a nil instance of the type, it should include a check for nil to avoid any runtime panics. This is crucial for methods that modify the state because attempting to modify a nil pointer would result in a runtime panic. Let's see this with an example. So this is an example from our past lesson. In here, in the main function of our program, we are initializing a rectangle struct with length and width and then calling area on it. What if rect is a nil pointer? Let's change it to b1. Here I'm saying variable rect is a pointer to rectangle. As you can see, Go allows us to call the method on the nil pointer. Now, let's run a program and see what happens. As you can see, we are getting invalid memory address or nil pointer dereference error. This means that in area method, when we try to access length on a nil pointer, we are getting invalid memory address because the memory address doesn't exist in the memory of the program. Instead, what we can do is we can add a small check here, which says if r is equal to nil, we just return 0. In production applications, you would instead return an error when a nil instance is passed. But for our example here, we are just doing a nil check and returning 0. So now, if we run our program, we should expect 0, which is the case here. So just keep that in mind, that when you have a pointer receiver method, the value could be nil and you should program your method according to it. This is something that we have discussed in the previous lesson, but let's go over it again. If a method only needs to read the state of the receiver without modifying it, a value receiver is appropriate. Value receivers are often more idiomatic for methods that are purely informational or do not change the state of the receiver. Sometimes you may also need to decide if to use a function or create a method for the type. In this case, the rule of thumb is to use a function if the business logic inside the function just works with the input provided to the function. In cases where the business logic inside the function involves the use of state on the object or type, it is recommended to create a method on the type. Let's cover pointer receiver in little more detail. In the example of the last lesson that we are using in this lesson too, you may have noticed that we are calling a pointer receiver method on the value itself. In Go, you can call a method with a pointer receiver on a value of that corresponding type. Let's change it back to rectangle value. So I can say rect is rectangle of length 5 and width 5. Now, as you can see, rect is a value type. It is not a pointer. But in here, we are allowed to call the area which accepts a pointer receiver. This is something that Go allows you to do. When you call a method with a pointer receiver on a value, Go automatically takes the address of the value and passes it as a pointer to the method. This behavior simplifies the syntax for method calls and allows for more consistent and expressive code. This is a tricky one. Please note that Go is purely call-by-value language. So if the correct pointer is not passed, you will not get the expected results. It is better explained with an example. So let's have a look at one. I'm just going to create a function here that's a wrapper around setLength function. Please note this is a function, not a method. So as you can see here, updateLength takes the rectangle and the new length. Inside it, it uses the rectangle to call the setLength method and sets the length. Now I'm just going to copy it down Between the two print statement, I'm going to call update length function with rect and then update the length to 20. Can you guess what the new value would be? Let's run the program and check it. Go run main.go. As you can see, the value hasn't been updated. This is because in update length, we are accepting a value. So since go is called by value, a copy of rectangle is created, and as such, when we call r.setLength, a pointer to the copy is passed by go. So the change is made on the copy and not on the original value. To get around it, we can accept a pointer. So in here, I pass the address of it. It's still accepting a copy of pointer, but since the copy pointer points to the original value, we will see that changes make up to the original data. Let's clear the console and run the program again. And you can see the length was updated. As such, the area was updated as well. Different values in Go will have different method sets. If you have a pointer to a type, you can call both the pointer receiver methods and a value receiver methods on that pointer. So as to say, a pointer value of a type will have both pointer receiver methods and value receiver methods in its sets. Go automatically dereferences the pointer when calling the value receiver method. In Go, an addressable value is the one that has an address, meaning it's stored in memory and can be pointed to. If value is addressable, you can call both pointer receiver methods and value receiver methods. So again, this means if the value is addressable, the method set for that value includes the value receiver and the pointer receiver method. If in case the value is not addressable, for example, if it's a literal or result of an expression or a function call, Go can't obtain a pointer to it. In such case, you can only call value receiver methods on that value. This means if the value is not addressable, the method set only includes the value receiver methods. Let's now summarize everything we have learned in this lesson. First, we saw which method type to use when. The choice between a value receiver and a pointer receiver for a method depends on the intended behavior of the method. Use a value receiver when the method doesn't need to modify the state of the receiver and is more informational or does not change the internal state. Use a pointer receiver when the method needs to modify the state of the receiver or when it's more efficient to operate on a reference rather than a copy. Next, we learn that when working with methods that have a pointer receiver, it's essential to handle the case where the receiver is none. This is particularly crucial for methods that might be called on uninitialized instances. The method should check if the receiver is nil and handle this case gracefully to avoid runtime panic. We went over if a value is addressable, that is, it has an address in memory, you can use a pointer receiver method on that value. Go automatically takes the rest of the value when calling a pointer receiver method on it. That's it for the lesson. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, please feel free to comment under the video or reach out through our Discord server. See you in the next lesson. Happy coding.